ChristianGeekCentral.com.
Well, my editing skills are crap, but can the same thing be said about the Dark Crystal Age of Resistance, the premiere episode? Stick around and find out. Hey, I'm Peter Franson from ChristianGeekCentral.com and Spirit Blade Productions, here with my uncut review of the Dark Crystal Age of Resistance premiere episode. that's a mouthful. I'm not going to review the full series. I mean, well, there's the possibility that I would review the entire season. I'm going to see just kind of what the response is, the clicks I get on the review for this premiere episode. I'm also going to review the first episode of Carnival Row on Amazon Prime later on today. So I didn't have time to just totally binge Dark Crystal Age of Resistance. But let's talk about that premiere. The synopsis on IMDb for the series as a whole says, returns to the world of Thra. I guess they mean this show, returns to the world of Thra, where three Gelfling discover the horrifying secret behind the Skeksis' power and set out to ignite the fires of rebellion and save their world. And you know where the Skeksis get their power if you've seen the original movie, which this is a prequel to. You don't have to know anything about that movie in order to enjoy this one. Obviously, I think you'll appreciate this movie more if you've seen the original. You'll appreciate the callbacks and like some of the opening shots of this. I'm like, oh my gosh, this is like seeing the opening shots of the original movie, but like in this brilliant HD, you know, and modern technology and stuff. I mean, wow. I mean, there's a lot of neat things going on in just this premiere episode alone. Let's talk about the story and the pacing and the tone. It's, you know, it's a fantasy, of course, and it has some dramatic elements for sure, but also much more action than the original movie. If you go over to, gosh, I'm going to get it wrong, but the guys on the Retro Rewind podcast, I think it's RetroRewindPod.com, or RetroRewindPodcast.com. Anyway, we link to it. They're part of the Christian Geek Central Network at ChristianGeekCentral.com, so you can find them from there. But if you go there and search for Dark Crystal, I joined those guys for a discussion about that original Dark Crystal movie, and so you can get my full thoughts on, you know, what I think today of that original movie. Mixed feelings. In general, I think it's a classic, but not something that I would really gravitate toward watching today, largely because of the pacing. And so I feel like maybe they really have recognized in hindsight, you know, that movie was a little slower, at least by today's standards. It feels a little bit sleepy, a little bit slow. And so there is a lot more action, especially in the first half of this premiere. And the premiere episode's 54 minutes long. I haven't checked the runtime of the typical episodes after that. But, I mean, that's almost the length of, I think the original movie was close to an hour and a half, maybe. So, I mean, this is a mammoth production for them to be doing, I think, like 10 episodes. And just the first one is already more than half the length of the original movie, you know, and is, I think, much more spectacular in visually, even, than the original movie. Anyway, but lots of action in the first half, and even continuing in the second half as well. A fairly serious tone, but with kind of what I would describe as cartoonish trappings in the form of the puppets and how the puppets move, and also sometimes the cartoonish voices of especially the Skeksis, but also a few supporting characters as well. The plot elements, though, definitely have some grown-up aspects to them, you know, dealing with oppressive leaders and corrupt government, things that, like, you know, younger kids won't really have an appreciation for. But, you know, the execution definitely feels suited stylistically to an audience of children, you know, so it fits in that family movie area where I think there's going to be things that the grown-ups will kind of have some reference points for that the kids won't, but definitely it's going to have, you know, aspects to keep kids interested. In short, the tone, I think, is very similar to the original. The vibe, if you will, is very similar to the original, but with more action and faster pacing. That would be the main difference, I would say. As far as the cast and the performances, you know, this is a different animal that we're talking about here. It's not animation. The performances are made up of voice actors and then also the puppeteers. You know, sometimes multiple puppeteers working on each creature or character in order to bring their performance in that character to life. The voice acting is fairly subtle and grounded among the Gelfling protagonists, which are the most human-looking creatures in this world and I think are meant to be stand-ins for the common viewer, you know? But the voice acting is comically cartoonish among the villainous Skeksis, as in the original. So both of those things very faithful to the original voice performance styles, I think. The puppets also function and are performed in a way that's consistent with the original, to a fault for my tastes. To connect with a story, in general, in any medium, I need characters I can relate to. And so when it comes to live action or animated, you know, movies or video or series or whatever, you know, I need the performances, whether they're CG animation or in this case puppets, I need those performances to really convey emotions well. Preferably, it's always going to be preferable for me to have a really great actor doing subtle things to add subtext to the script. You know, these days, a script alone just isn't going to engage with me, with my emotions in a story. I need an actor that can bring subtext, things that are not, you know, just in the dialogue itself, that add richness and relatability to the characters, you know. And while no one does puppets better than the Jim Henson Company, you know, they still don't compare here to having a real actor's face and subtle emotional expression. The mouths, especially in their movements, are rah, 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 rah. They are a far cry from human. In fact, I think even, I haven't done a side-by-side comparison, so maybe I'm having rose-tinted lenses when I think about Yoda, but I think even Yoda had better, more articulated lip movement than the Gelfling characters in this show, which is really kind of a shame. You know, I wish that, because I know there have been advancements in kind of the particulars of what you can do with facial animation in puppets and animatronics, and I wish we could have seen some more of that advancement in the Gelflings. Maybe that would have been too much, because there's so many Gelflings that have to be represented here, so maybe I'm asking for something that's unrealistic, but I still would have really liked it, and I think it would have been very helpful to the end of me connecting, you know, with this story emotionally. I love practical effects, and I prefer practical to CGI almost every time. But I wonder if CG animated faces would have been easier for me to connect with. I don't think they would have been much easier for me to connect with, and I don't think they would have helped me to connect with this story in the way that I wanted to. But I'm curious if I would have connected a little bit better. I certainly would have connected better had they been actors, but of course then they wouldn't have been Gelflings, you know, it would have been very different from the original. I'd love a world this lavishly produced and designed featuring actors in makeup as the main characters we're meant to identify with rather than these puppets. I mean, I'm thinking to myself, man, if only the Jim Henson Company did some kind of TV show like that with new incredible creatures every week, but that still centers around powerful human actor performances. Oh, wait, they did that already. It's a little show called Farscape, the best television series ever made. I'm thinking to myself, crap, come on, Sci-Fi Channel. You've been saying that for years now that you're going to get a new series going of Farscape, and you've been working with the Henson Company. How did you let the Henson folks get nabbed up to do Dark Crystal? Fight for Farscape! I don't know, maybe it's possible that the Henson Company could be doing this and also do pre-production and production on another show that's just as lavish, but that would be very, very surprising to me. Anyway, as far as like the stunts and the visuals, it's really a lavish, detailed, wondrous spectacle, you know? And again, I've just seen the premiere so far, so it's almost all I want in a fantasy film production on the visual side of things, you know. The puppets may fall short in their expressiveness, but at least they're real. They are there. They are practical. I could touch them if I was there. And that means something to me. That makes a difference for me in embracing a fantasy world, you know. This is a real artistic accomplishment, I think, that really makes me curious about what else they will show us throughout the rest of this season. Now, as far as themes go, is there anything of moral, philosophical, or spiritual significance going on that might trigger some worthwhile thought or conversation? I don't know. It's pretty under the radar right now, I think, relatively speaking. There are corrupt authorities as a main theme, possibly even religious authorities, as the Skeksis are the authorities in this world, and they are even even paid tithes, they're called, by the Gelflings, and they're treated with this sort of religious awe. The Dark Crystal is also referred to as the Crystal of Truth. It's this very revered object. It is synonymous with the life of the planet itself, though in what sense it is the Crystal of Truth, I don't know. I'm wondering if that's going to be expressed later on in the series, and if so, I wonder what truths the crystal will reveal. And that could say a lot about what the worldview of the developers, if the crystal ever becomes a mouthpiece for any kind of view. Well, as the Crystal of Truth, you know, that's a pretty big statement. So I would definitely want to keep an eye on what they might have to say about the crystal being the Crystal of Truth later on in the show. There's a potential theme, I think, of anti-authority in general, as there's this closing monologue that has a Skeksi claiming that the Gelflings need to be ruled. They need to be ruled. They want to be ruled because they are weak. You know, and that's, I think, meant to leave us as an audience who are meant to identify with the Gelflings saying to ourselves, no, no, that shouldn't be. They can be strong. They don't need to be ruled by anyone, you know. And if the Gelflings represent the common viewer, as I'm pretty sure they are, I'd want to say that we are actually, it's a little more nuanced than that. Biblically speaking, we are made to both be ruled and to rule. But the problem is we're broken, and so ruling ourselves, even with appointed rulers that we vote on and put over ourselves, that's not working very well, you know? It hasn't been. It hasn't ever worked as well as we would all want it to work. And sometimes it's disastrous, you know? We need a ruler who doesn't have our brokenness. And we need to be transformed ourselves and rid of that brokenness before we can truly be the rulers that we were meant to be. Now, finally, it's also been confirmed, as far as themes go, that there are some same-sex relationships, possibly same-sex marriages, I'm not sure if it's going to be that formal, that are represented in the series. Now, I only watched the premiere episode, and I only saw the barest references to this in the premiere. In fact, I was like, is this going on, what I think is going on here? And I had to get online to kind of confirm that. So, you know, there's really nothing in the first episode that I noticed that is really worth talking about, and so I'm not really going to comment on this aspect of the show, except to say that, you know, as Christians, I don't think we should expect that even shows geared toward children, as this one in many ways seems to be, are going to send all the right messages, you know. Children's shows have been sending all kinds of, for example, self-centered messaging for decades that goes way too far in the self-centered, self-empowerment, self-focused direction, you know. So, I mean, this is nothing new. This just happens to be a different kind of message that, you know, isn't a great one. And the inclusion of same-sex couples shouldn't necessarily make this something that we can't watch with our kids. In fact, while possibly uncomfortable, I think it could be a great starting point for some really important conversations that I think we should have with our kids early on. I think the earlier the better when it comes to discussing issues of biblical sexuality versus popular views of sexuality with our kids. All right, well, I have no idea what your tastes are in TV shows and fantasy and all that stuff, but if I were a time traveler, I would go back in time and say, Peter, oh man, well, this isn't a big shocker to you, but go ahead and skip this one. I mean, Holly is maybe interested in watching some more of it, and if both she and the boys watch it together, then, you know, get back into it so that you can, you know, maybe have that experience with them. But this just isn't for you personally. Certainly it's an artistic achievement worthy of respect, but it's just not an experience you're going to connect with in the way that you really want to with your TV shows and movies these days. All right, this one is not rated by the MPAA, but it's described as IMDb as TVPG. I would just comment that it has, you know, a few brief, gross, pus-like effects, which I was like, oh man, that's cool and repulsing, you know? But no real violence or blood. So those would be my only comments on that. Those are my thoughts on the premiere. I'd love to get yours in the comments below. Please like, share, subscribe, click that notification bell, and then I hope you'll join us soon over at ChristianGeekCentral.com as we continue to geek out and seek the truth. Hey guys, thanks for tuning in. We've got a ton going on here at Spirit Blade Productions and Christian Geek Central, including our in-depth Bible study for geeks, movie, game, and other entertainment reviews or commentary, live streams, Christian geek news, original audio dramas, and tons more. And on top of all that, you can become a Spirit Blade Insider with an influential voice and get access to exclusive content and rewards. It's your involvement as a patron that will keep all of this going and growing, so I want to thank you for your consideration in that. For more information, please check out our Patreon page through the link below at patreon.com/spiritbladeproductions. Thanks for listening.